Hello and welcome again to today's presentation, Diabetes and Pain Management. Before we get started, we'd like to cover a couple pieces of housekeeping. We do have browser requirements for this webinar. In order to view it, we do require Safari 3.0, Firefox 4.0, Chrome 5.0, Internet Explorer 7.0 or newer. In order to get the best audio quality, we do recommend calling in using a landline instead of your computer speakers. Today, all participants are muted. In order to ask a question or make a comment, please submit via the question feature, and we'll address your question during the Q&A. The question feature is located on the control panel to your right. Today's webinar is also being recorded. The recording will be sent to all registrants in the follow-up email. We'd like to remind everybody we do not offer credits for our dLife edutainment series. But for upcoming webinars, diabetes tools, online resources, or to become a dLife member, it's all absolutely free. Visit www.dlife.com/member. I'd like to just introduce today's host, Dr. Mandeep Brar. She is a board-certified endocrinologist, and she is the director of the Diabetes Care Center and chief of the Division of Endocrinology at Abrazo Health Systems. Dr. Brar, thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you, Leah. We've got a great topic today on pain management that I think everyone, whether you have diabetes or not, can relate to. And helping us today identify ways of managing pain are Amy Baxter, CEO of MMJ Labs, board certified in emergency care, and director of research, emergency research, Scottish Rite Children's Healthcare of Atlanta. And our second panelist is Christopher Jacobs, founder of Genteel LLC. He holds a PhD in biomedical engineering from the University of Southern California. I'm very pleased to welcome them today.
Thank you, Dr. Burr.
So there are many types of pain related to diabetes, a subject that we can talk about for many hours. But in order to keep us focused today, we'll talk about pain and injectable therapy, finger sticks, which is poking the finger to check your blood glucose. Having said that, some of the approaches we go over today can also be applied to other types of diabetes pain. What we'll try to do today is introduce hopefully new ways to look at pain, encourage a more open conversation about pain in regards to the needed therapies to maintain better blood glucose control. We will actually present some directional research information that has not yet been published, but will make us consider alternatives in regards to how to deal with pain. So today we'll cover the following: injectable therapy in diabetes, self-monitoring of blood glucose, needle fear in diabetes, approaching pain, and ways to manage pain. One of the most important things that we can remember is all pain is not the same. What do I mean by that? Sometimes the doctor or a caregiver, we have to remember that pain may not feel the same to each of us. For example, here in our clinic, all of our staff, medical assistants, front staff, our practice manager, including myself, from time to time will wear an insulin pump, or we'll wear a continuous glucose monitor, or do a finger stick, maybe even a saline injection, to see how we feel compared to our patients. And we ask our patients how they feel when they've gone through their first set of injections. And we've noticed a considerable difference in how we all react and how we feel. Some of us are very nervous prior to even poking ourselves, and some of us feel more pain when we actually do the injection or the stick. So although we can't say you can stop injecting to take away the pain, we'd love to be able to say that, it's important to first understand why injectable therapy is important. One of the first steps in managing anything is acceptance. So what is the importance of injectable therapy when it comes to diabetes? So insulin is required by about 100% of people with type 1 diabetes to survive. It's given either through an injection or an infusion via an insulin pump, And the main importance clinically is that it allows us to attain good glycemic control, preventing development of diabetes-related complications. Now, everybody may think that's an obvious thing, but a lot of times that doesn't sink in. How do you prevent the complications from diabetes is to maintain your blood sugar and your A1C at your particular goal. And in type 1 diabetes, that's by taking your insulin injections and checking your finger sticks. Injectable therapy is prescribed about 30 to 40% of the time for people with type 2 diabetes, either as insulin or as a GLP-1 therapy, or maybe even both. And the importance of this is we're trying to preserve beta cell function when we initiate this early. Beta cells are what make insulin for us naturally, and we're trying to prevent what we think is actually a natural loss of insulin production in people with type 2 diabetes over time by starting insulin or GLP-1 therapy early. Many people use insulin as a threat to patients, saying that you'll most likely require insulin if you don't control your blood sugars, or you'll get complications and you'll need insulin. But we should consider insulin therapy more as something that will help us maintain a healthier lifestyle with type 2 diabetes. GLP-1 agonist therapy, such as Victoza, Byetta, Bydureon, and many others, have a significant blood glucose improvement as well as A1C improvement when taken appropriately and started early. And it acts on a significant pathologic defect of type 2 diabetes, which is the loss of GLP-1 hormone that was naturally present when the person was not diabetic. Next slide. So this slide demonstrates that approximately 2.9 million people with diabetes are on insulin therapy. This does not include the people that are on GLP-1 therapy, and this is not divided up between type 1s and type 2s. So you're not alone when it comes to the number of people that are actually having a conversation about requiring injections or on injectable therapy. Next slide, Leah. Thank you. The impact of needle fear on diabetes is huge. It's very important and not very often discussed. So 33% of people, and this is just the general population, not specific to people with diabetes, have experienced some level of dread relating to insulin injections. According to a survey commissioned by the American Association of Diabetes Educators, about 47% of people would be more likely to take their injections regularly if there was a way to ease pain and discomfort. And I say this often in clinic to my patients, and excuse how unsophisticated this will sound, that I would probably suck as a diabetic. With all that I know, diabetes is not easy, especially when it comes to the pain component, doing injections, and checking your finger sticks. So this is a very important conversation to discuss. Next slide. So it's important to understand that some people's pain starts before the needle penetrates the skin. And we need to realize that this is real. Dr. Baxter, from your extensive research in pain management, can you help us understand a little more about needle fear and also talk to how some people may be more susceptible to pain due to their hereditary reasons?
Sure, absolutely. You know, I think when we think about needle fear, there is a big shame about it in this country. You know, it's just a shot and it's just a little needle. When you're in medicine, you realize that there is huge variability, like you talked about, that different people are going to feel pain differently, and different people are going to have responses both to injections and also to pump management and to finger sticks that are not the same as other people. I think that we all understand that there's variability in medicine, but with needle fear, as people giving care or people having diabetes, we have to realize that doctors are on the very far end of not being bothered by needles. To the extent that there is variability, the fear actually ends up clustering in the general population. It's kind of a tail. And so the not much fear end of the scale is now almost forming a wave. So the number of the population that have some degree of needle fear has been increasing over time. When we think about the extreme fear, most people think about passing out with a needle. Actually, that's not a fear. That's a genetic response. It's called a vasovagal syncope, vasovagal stimulus. And it turns out that it's sort of a warrior trait. The warriors who were injured in battle or who had some kind of blood loss, if they dropped their blood pressure immediately, they would quit losing blood. And so if they passed out, their blood pressure went down, they didn't lose blood, they survived. So about 3 to 5% of people have this genetic predisposition to becoming lightheaded or actually fainting when exposed to sharp pain. So when we're talking about needle fear, what we're really talking about is a conditioned response to a sharp object or to the sensation. Now, if you're going to faint every time you get a needle, you're probably going to eventually not like needles. But it doesn't start as a fear. It starts as a genetic for about 5% of people. The reason that we have an increased problem with needle fear is that most people who develop needle phobia acquire the fear around age 4 or 5, and it's usually when they have a bad set of immunizations. What we have found in our research is that the amount of fear they have correlates with how many injections they got at one time. If you think about it, if you go to give blood and they get the blood in one stick, then you're probably willing to go back. But if it takes 5 times for them to get the blood draw, you're going to remember that experience whether you're afraid of needles or not. So now that we're giving 4 or 5 injections to children when they get their 4 to 5-year-old shots, they remember. So consequently, it used to be, and it still is in the older ages, so age 50 and up, our generation, 50 and up, about 10 to 25% of adults say that they have a fear of needles. But in younger generations, about 63% of children have a fear of needles and injections. So there is a big swell toward being afraid of needles, and it's really a medically conditioned fear. In 2010, Carter et al. Did a paper that found that 13% of adults who don't start injections for their diabetes therapy, it's because of needle phobia. So that's a 13% of an older population. But in 2013, a study found that 43% of women with gestational diabetes were afraid of needles, and that's why they didn't want to start. And so, again, you see that the younger they are, the more likely needle fear is going to play a part. So one last thing, in addition to that genetic issue, there's also differences in skin color, which impact the amount of pain that you feel. In fact, there's something called the melanocortin 1 receptor, the redheaded gene, and it causes more perception of pain in people with red hair. Women may actually experience more pain, require more pain medicine than men do for things. There are differences in the actual physiologic layout based on genetic underpinning. So I think that the take-homes from all of this are needle fear is on the rise. Needle fear is very different for different people, and it is a significant impact for our patients in whether or not they start timely insulin or adjunct injectable therapy.
Thank you, Dr. Baxter. So do you think needle fear is on the rise because we're talking about it more or for some other reason?
No, it's not. It definitely, if you plot out the research that looks at how much needle fear is found in studies at different times, in 1995, it was 10% of adults and 25% of children. Taddeo published a study in 2011 that showed that it's now 25% of adults and 63% of children. And in our work, we found a strong statistical correlation. If kids got 2 injections at one time when they were 4 to 6, only 26% of them were afraid of needles when they were 11 years old. But if they got 4 shots on one day, half of them were afraid of needles. And it was a strongly statistically significant correlation. The reason is because when up until about 1983, people only got 6 injections, 6 vaccines. And then in the year 2000, kids were getting 36 vaccines. Vaccines are fantastic. We have decreased preventable death 99%, but we have introduced 6 times more shots to this generation than what we grew up with. So it's not that we're talking about it more. It's that there's actually a conditioning that's happening to every single kid in the country, which is why people are not dying of measles, but it also contributes to why people are not wanting to give their kids so many shots. They feel that there's something wrong with that. And in fact, there is a correlation between lifelong fear and what happens when you're 4 to 6 years old.
That's very interesting. As an adult endocrinologist, I don't see pediatric patients. The correlation between what happens to us at our younger life when we're cared for a different subset of providers and how that influences us when we're, 40, 50, or 60 years of age.
Yeah, well, I did a TED Med talk on it. Go watch my TED talk. But it really is, it's new. I mean, this is just something, it's only been about 15 years that we've been giving so many injections, and the research with needle fear is only coming out in the last 3 to 4 years. So we're just now realizing, oops.
Wow, that's impressive.
and not oops, because we don't have nearly as many deaths from other things. But, I think that this is also concomitant with the realization that we have drastically more fear of needles than we used to. And even still, 13% of an older population being needle phobic and not wanting to start injections, that's significant. That's more than 10%. But there are a lot of different ways that we can deal with this. So to think about how to approach needle fear and pain, we can really learn a lot from the pediatric research and apply it to our adult patients as well. Next slide.
So that reminds us that not all pain is created equal.
Yeah, exactly. And I think that again, as physicians, we are on the tail end that needles do not bother us. And there's a disdain of, you're going to have to get used to this and don't be such a baby. But we need to realize some empathy that we self-select. Go ahead to the next one. We self-select to not be bothered by the pain. But regardless of who you are, it really isn't about the physical pain. What we need to treat is this combination of both the physical pain, the fear of what's happening, and how much focus is on it. Explanation. If you think about a scary movie where someone is a dentist is torturing someone and pulling out their teeth, that is far more pain that person would experience than if they go to a nice, sympathetic dentist who is doing exactly the same procedure, but is doing it kindly and for a good reason. So the fear of what's going on is helped by understanding what's going to happen and why it's happening, and not having threats, not having any kind of a negative association with that procedure. So this is one reason why, man up, get over it, quit being so afraid. Those kinds of things can actually make fear worse can make pain worse because it is adding to the fear. The other part that's really important that needs to be addressed in someone who has a fear of needles is helping them with the focus at the time of the injection. Because if you think about, say, sports. If you're running around outside and you twist your ankle, you might ignore it. But as soon as you get home or you're trying to go to sleep, that's when you feel pain. When you're bored and you're not doing anything and you don't have anything else to do except for focus on that pain, that's when you feel it the most. So whether it's a physical sensation or whether it's a cognitive distraction, having something else to pay attention to during a blood draw, an injection, a lancing, distractions can actually be a huge part. So making sure that you're not focused on the pain itself, but focused on something else. It could be focused on the procedural part. It could be focused on counting. We'll talk about that in a minute. But it's really important to realize that to address a fearful patient, we have to both directly talk about the pain, but talk about the fear and the focus as well. So the different ways to prepare a patient based on whether or not it's a type 1 or a type 2. Some of the reasons that these are different is because a type 1 is more likely to be a pediatric patient. And so they're going to be in this generation where they've been conditioned to already be afraid of needles. The other reason it's different is because a type 1 patient isn't going to have a choice, isn't going to be able to delay. They need to start when they need to start. So for that reason, what we found is that for type 1 patients, it's better to do everything possible to make it comfortable and a positive experience right off the bat. I think that many physicians who are used to fixing something quickly or used to just saying, you know, you're just going to have to deal with this, may be inclined to say, I don't want to give you a crutch. I don't want to give you a whole bunch of rigmarole with your injections because you're not going to be able to go through doing that the rest of your life. What we've actually found is if you address the pain and you teach them some coping techniques early on, immediately, then over time, usually 1 or 2 months, they'll get to the place where they don't need to do all the steps. They don't need to do all the coping skills. They've gotten used to the sensation enough that they no longer really have that fear and associate that. With a type 2 patient, it's a lot more important to address and really understand where they are coming from and to validate it. So there's a diabetes fear of injecting and self-testing survey measure that actually was published in 2001. And so you can specifically quantify how afraid that patient may be of needles, but it's probably just as good to have an open-ended and understanding discussion. I mean, look, if 43% of women had a fear that stopped them with gestational diabetes from injecting, you got to know that almost half of your patients may have some degree of trepidation. So everybody should be able to have some discussion about, you know, look, needles bother a lot of us. Where are you on this? Which parts bother you more? What is your experience? Find out some of these things, and so then you can make more specific strategies to address that. Language is important. Criticizing, mocking, making fun of adults or children have been shown to decrease their comfort and increase their fear. So it may seem kind of obvious, but you know, telling somebody that you're going to threaten them if they don't just sit there and be still and take their injection, that actually is going to make it worse than next time. The other part of all of this with the behaviors is to realize that anything that happens the very first time is a template for the next time. So you want to make these first experiences the best possible so that that's what their memory is, that's what the patient's experience is. And distraction, both for children and adults, while they are going to get the injection, if they're really, really anxious, directing them to look at something visual and count is probably the single best distraction. It's much better to do something active, finding an item, looking at something, rather than just passively talking or passively taking, having them watch television or something like that.
That's very interesting, Dr. Baxter. I've noticed in my own practice that children, people who are diagnosed with type 1 diabetes as children who then see me as adults, if they were taught to cope well with the sudden drastic change in their lifestyle that will be with them forever, they actually have a tendency to do much better in regards to preventing complications and dealing with other life events such as pregnancy or other illnesses.
Well, you know, that's exactly right. We see that in the ICU. Patients that are taught how to cope with painful procedures still use those same techniques 6 months later, and they continue to use them 2 years later. So once you learn how to cope with pain, that is a trait that and a skill that carries with patients. But it does mean that we need to be willing to take a little more time on the front end with both pediatric and adult patients so that they can feel that mastery rather than feeling overwhelmed.
And Dr. Baxter, I understand from our previous discussions in preparation for this webinar that even the use of certain words by providers and caregivers can make a big difference in pain management. Can you talk to this a little bit as well?
Yeah, it's really interesting work by particularly Ron Blount that found that words like sharp, poke, stick, sting, all of those increase cortisol and increase pain perception. And if words like squeeze, strong push, pressure, those words don't trigger that same kind of response. So you're not increasing the fear and you're not increasing the distress. There's also, again, this concept, you know, a lot of what figures into fear is shame and having been threatened. And so you have the fight or flight response. So if you can increase words that are understanding. Empathy itself for children is not good. Saying, I'm sorry, I know, honey, that's too bad. That actually turns out to be worse. But just being very matter of fact and supportive is the best way. So don't use the words like stick, poke, pain, hurt. Instead, use comfortable, bother, squeeze, pressure. And don't criticize, don't apologize, and don't reassure. Just be very matter of fact. And, you know, I know you can do it. You can do this. We're going to do so much to make it incredibly comfortable. And then you can choose, as we go forward in your treatment, which of these things work best for you. Putting the patient in the position of the scientist, the experimenter, giving them control of what pain management resources they use also helps decrease that fear, decrease the feeling of being out of control, and lets them focus on paying attention to what is working for them and what isn't.
Great. So let's move on to the heart of what everybody wants to know. How do we best manage pain? Dr. Baxter, why don't you go first?
Well, I have spoken so much that I'll be really quick. When you're starting out, topical anesthetics such as Elimex, which is a cream that needs to be on for about 20 minutes, it'll just numb the surface of the skin, but it's something that can help. There is a prescription called Emla that will penetrate about a half a centimeter, and that will take about an hour to 2 hours to work. But those are two things, particularly for children, that are good to start with. And they're also good for continuous glucose monitors and good for pump placement. So eventually over time, especially with insulin syringes, which are so small, they may not get that same kind of pain sensation. But just to make it so they really feel as little as possible, those topical anesthetics are a great way to start. The other way, using distractions, like I said, there are cards that have been tested that full disclosure, are one of the things that we invented, but they're called distraction cards. What the research shows is that counting and finding visual things are really good distractions. So it doesn't have to be our cards, but any kind of visual distraction right at the time. A poster, something on the wall, a picture, can you find four windows? If it's being done in an office, you can always count ceiling tiles. And then finally, things like natural, like deep breathing and stretching are things that can be really helpful in having another part of the body that decreases that sensation. The other thing you can do, next slide, is that if you think about it, the brain can only cope with so many different kinds of sensations at one time. I mean, it's bandwidth. And so if you stimulate another sensation in the same nerve pathway, like, for example, vibration, everybody's seen a dentist jiggling a jaw, or if you bump your elbow, you rub it. That vibration sensation is actually competing with pain. If you burn your finger and put it under cold water, it completely disappears, and that's called gate control. So the Buzzy device uses high-frequency vibration and ice, and you put it between the brain and the pain during a finger stick, during an injection, and that kind of competing sensation can also help naturally decrease the pain. You don't have to use this. You could use any vibration source of high enough frequency. Ice does the same kind of thing. It will give a competing stimulation, so the brain can't feel as much pain because the attention of the brain is feeling something that runs along the same set kind of nerves, this motion or this vibration or this cold.
Great, thanks, Cass. And Chris, you've done some really interesting research that's quite unique about lancets and how we can reduce pain when poking our fingers to check a finger stick. Can you share with us what you found and some tips on how patients can manage pain simply through the proper use of lancets?
Yes. Lancets come in an extraordinarily large quality range. And actually, we found some lancets, some brands and marks of lancets, are so bad that the needle comes out of the plastic bent. In other words, not quite bent enough to, if you held it up and looked at it, you would see a bend, but it only takes a 10-degree bend to double the size of the hole that will be put in wherever you lance yourself, alternate sites or fingertips. So what we have done is looked at literally hundreds of different brands of lancets and divided them into categories, recommended, acceptable, unacceptable, and so on. And we have found there is a considerable correlation between bad quality lancets and pain, good quality lancets and comfort when you're doing finger or alternate site testing. What is shown on the slide here is just four of our top winners, but anybody that wants to get more can just go to our website and look under lancets, and there's a considerable depth of lancet brands and models that would do it. The website is, of course, mygenteel.com, mygenteel.com. But that's really what we did. We are much more focused on preventing the start of whatever would make the pain, and Dr. Brar and Amy are really good, amazingly good. I'm impressed with how well they can handle. If you have to traumatize the person so much, how do you do that without it? We're all about not traumatizing in the first place. The needle can be bent. Yes.
I was about to say, what lancing tips can we use to reduce pain for our patients? I think you were just about to get into that slide.
Yes. First of all, the types of things that make one lancet more painful than the other. One of the misconceptions is the thinner the needle, the less pain. That's not necessarily true, for the simple reason that you have to go deeper with a thinner needle in order to get the same path for the blood to flow out. It turns out that from our research, we found that the capillaries are slightly closer to the surface of the skin than are the pain nerves. So if you can make it work out so that you just reach the capillaries but not go so deeply as to reach the pain nerves, your lancing process will be a lot less painful. And so the slide is showing the needles can be bent and easily bent when you're removing the safety cap. Let me tell you what happened in our labs. All of a sudden, for some reason, we would have a patient that it hurt, and we don't know why, and it even bruised a little bit. When we checked the lancets, we found that while the person was removing the safety cap, they were pulling it off at an angle, not paying attention, talking, doing something else, and inadvertently, they were bending the needle. Now, once we alerted our patients, don't do that. Pay attention when you're pulling the safety cap off. It was like a light switch was just turned off. That whole problem went away. So for those listening, be very careful when you're, and I know that it's not a difficult thing to do, but be very careful when you're removing the safety cap that you do pull it straight off, not paying attention to something else and pulling it off at an angle like you were twisting a bottle cap off at an angle. No, pull it straight off. You don't need instruments. You don't need special procedures. Just pay attention. It'll work great.
So then also probably placing the device flat on the fingertip, try not to angle it when you're doing that second step, and making sure that you switch out the lancet needle with every use, as it does get dull and it may have a little bit of blood left on it from the previous use. So these are important basic tips to maintain finger stick pain at its minimum. Now, Chris,
one interesting point that Chris brings up is that for insulin injection, there actually hasn't been any statistical difference found between longer needles or shorter needles. So that doesn't seem to matter for pain, but patients prefer thinner, shorter needles. So for the anxious patient, even though there isn't any statistical support that a 29-gauge versus a 30-gauge, 31-gauge makes any difference, for those patients who are anxious, they are often reassured by using a shorter, thinner needle, even though technically there's no pain difference between them.
And that's a great point, Dr. Baxter, because as I, you know, introduce injections to patients here in clinic, I actually try to show them the needle that they're going to use. And as the needles have gotten shorter and thinner, and we can use some pen needles as well, patients' response over the years has been much more pleasant, I must say, to going down the road of injectable therapy. So thank you for that. And Chris, it seems as though your company has done some directional data with a small group of patients that might shed some light on pain and injecting at different sites. Can you go through this slide for us, please?
This was more done. It's interesting. We are mainly interested in our research is in getting blood out as opposed, in other words, pulling fluid out versus putting fluid in. Injecting is putting fluid in, and blood draw is pulling fluid out. This data is a relative data of what different areas that you can draw blood from, what's commonly called finger stick, but on alternate sites. And fingertips were by far the most painful, and at 8.5, just call that a relative rating. Versus other areas of the body. And this, so if you wish to try alternate sites, this chart, if you could save it, would give you a hint as to where the least painful areas of the body would be for drawing blood. Now, I don't know, I'd have to be transparent, I don't know if this would also apply to injections. I just know this applies to blood draw.
And I'd like to point out here in regards to alternative sites, if we can go back to that slide, it is appropriate in some instances to use an alternative site to check a blood glucose, but definitely not in the instance of when blood glucoses are uncontrolled, either high or low for a chronic period of time or acutely changing blood glucoses. So if a person with diabetes is feeling as though they're having a low blood glucose reaction, checking an alternative site is actually delayed anywhere from 5 to 10 minutes in regards to what the blood glucose is going to be if you compared it to the finger stick. And it'll be a little bit higher than what you would expect for what you're feeling. So in those instances, using the alternative sites would not be appropriate.
Absolutely. Absolutely correct. It's for the static, even your routine blood glucose testing, not for dynamic situations at all.
And tell us a little bit about alternative devices used for lancing, Chris.
There's two principles. The traditional devices, which most people that have done blood sticks know about, go in fingers. Or it's more difficult with traditional devices to get blood from different areas of the body. The alternate site, like the Gentile or the Essentia VacuLance, work in the following way. As we said earlier, the capillaries are closer to the surface of the skin than are the pain nerves. By properly controlling the depth of lancing to just reach the capillaries, you wouldn't get enough blood in a traditional lancer, but if you immediately, as soon as the lance process or during the lancing process, apply a vacuum over that lance site, like every child knows that drinks a milkshake through a straw, the vacuum will draw up an equal amount of blood as if you had lanced painfully and more deeply. So that's basically the principle of the alternative devices, all of them, including the Gentile. Lance much more shallow. You wouldn't get enough blood if it weren't for the vacuum. Immediately apply a vacuum on top of that, and in some cases you can go back to the same lance site and redraw blood all day long with just applying the vacuum and no lancing.
That is very interesting. So let me ask both of you a question to kind of put those last couple of slides together. I've had patients that tell me they're going to do a finger stick and they go ahead, they prepare everything, they press the button, they hear the click. They felt pain, but they didn't actually have a mark on their finger and no blood was drawn. Amy, can you talk to, can you perceive pain without having even been poked? And then Chris, can you relate that again to maybe some variability in finger sticks and lancing through our traditional devices?
You know, Mandeep, that I'm a pediatrician, so it's very common that we have a child who's already afraid of needles, and when the nurse begins to use the alcohol swab to clean off the arm where the injection is going to go, the child is screaming as if they're being amputated. So this goes back to that diagram where the fear in what they are expecting can be so great that it makes them hypersensitive. And so even a light touch, even if they only feel the touch of the edge of the lancet, but they don't feel the needle because the needle didn't go in, that can be perceived as intense pain. And that's one of the reasons why, you know, for example, there was a 9-year-old we had who was terrified of needles, whose father called me and said, they say your glucose is 451 and go to the emergency room. What does this mean? We know what this means. And because of her extreme fear for needles, the way that we got her used to her insulin therapy was when she was going to have either a finger stick or she was going to have insulin, for the injections, she actually had the topical anesthetic about 20 minutes before. She had the LMX over-the-counter one. And they put the vibration on with Buzzy. And so every time, initially, she used Buzzy for finger sticks. She used it for the injections. She used a visual distraction. She had some books that she looked at so that she was doing the same thing, and she got into this routine. Well, over about 3 or 4 days, she got to the place where maybe she didn't always use the same books, or maybe she didn't use a book at all. And over the first 2 months, she got to the place where she didn't even need to use the Buzzy anymore for injections and maybe only uses it for pump placement now. So the point is that going full court press to begin with can help overwhelm some of that incredible fear, because certainly when you're concentrating all of your observation powers on one area of your body, you're going to feel anything that happens in that area. So if you're doing a finger stick and all the sensation you have going on is concentrated on that, even if it's a light touch with the end of a lancet, you can perceive that as pain if your focus and your fear are so revved up.
We've experienced exactly the same thing as Dr. Baxter. That there is perception involved. In fact, we've had cases where there was no lance in it, and the person thought that there was no lance in the genteel, and they thought maybe it hurt. No, maybe it didn't. I'm not sure. And they couldn't tell the difference if the lance was in or not. So. It is. There is some psychology involved.
So what that tells us after this very interesting discussion, I thank you both very much, is that needle fear is real. It's multifactorial. It's very complex. It's something that needs to be part of the discussion. Providers need to be more aware. Caregivers need to be aware. And people who have type 1 or type 2 diabetes should also feel much more comfortable and not stigmatized in discussing this with those involved in their care. And we also need to actively treat the pain with various techniques that Dr. Baxter was kind enough to share through her research. So I'd like to thank you all very much for listening to us in regards to pain and diabetes. I'd like to open it up for any questions.
So one question that was put to us was that there was a person rotating injection spots, but they found the perfect spot that didn't hurt at all. And over time, now, for some reason, that site is hurting. What's up with that? So if you think about pain nerves as an alarm system, if you have a window of your house that gets broken into, you're going to put more alarms there. And even if someone is no longer breaking into that area, the alarms are still there, and they may trigger sometimes when nothing's going on. So what we found is that when one area has a repeated painful stimulus, more pain nerves actually grow, and your brain devotes more bandwidth to paying attention to that one area. So when you're not rotating sites, the body starts learning that it's getting broken into in this one area and will actually send more pain focus and increases the perception of pain to be able to defend that area. So that's one of the reasons why it really is good to pick and to try to use different areas to avoid that hypersensitivity and increased nociception. But it basically just means you've grown more pain nerves and your brain has become more attuned to the pain sensation coming from that area.
Great. And now we have a second question. And the question is, I was taught to never, and that's capitalized, do finger sticks on anywhere else other than the fingertips. Is that at all true? And when would it be appropriate to use an alternative site? This is a very complex answer. If you ask endocrinologists, the majority of us, either adult or pediatric, prefer the finger as a site for blood glucose. It gives us the most true, most real-time reading for that moment, for whatever question we have, be it are you having a low or are you having a high. And that's why we all default to doing the finger stick for a blood glucose. But what we don't realize is the pain that may be involved, and the patients become fatigued with checking on the fingertips, considering that we do touch a lot of other things throughout the day. And so we may need to open our minds in regards to alternative sites. So if your blood glucoses are stable, if your blood glucoses your A1C is doing quite well, and you're feeling fine, and it's a routine a stick prior to a meal, it may be appropriate to use an alternative site. But if you feel like your blood glucose is elevated, if it's low, if you're in diabetic ketoacidosis, or you're having any type of concern about not feeling well, the finger stick will give you the most appropriate blood glucose at that moment. And always have an open discussion with your endocrinologist or your primary care provider, whomever is helping you with your diabetes care in that regard. So I hope that was helpful.
Yeah, experience has been the same, by the way. If the situation is static, as Dr. Brar said, alternate sites may be appropriate, but there is absolutely a 15 to 20 minute delay. Our experiments were to give patients 15 grams of fast-acting glucose, and you can see it on the fingertips 15 minutes before you see it on the rest of the body. So fingertips respond faster, alternate sites being less painful and giving your fingers a chance to heal are certainly appropriate for very static, where things are calmed down and they're your routine blood glucose tests.
The one thing about the fingertips is that the reason they're more painful is because their job in the body is to contact the world. So they have a lot more nerve density than the stomach, which does not need to read braille or do anything. So that said, nerves in the fingers run up each side of the finger. And so you can find it more sensitive if you do it directly on the pad of the fingertip. If you test on the side, instead of having both sides of the nerves which cross over on the pad, so you've got twice as many nerves, if you do it just on one side of the fingertip or the other, then there will be less pain because there's less nerve density.
Great. That's very helpful. Here's another question. Can you utilize a very low pain site right above the knee for subcutaneous injections? So it's an interesting question, but the answer is going to be no. And the reason is, you have to inject insulin into a subcutaneous pocket, so soft tissue or fat tissue. You don't want to inject it where it's very close to tendons, muscles, and not a lot of fat for it to sit in, as that's part of its mechanism of action. So I would love to decrease pain, but that would not be a very good site. And if you accidentally got into any amount of muscle, that would cause a rapid absorption of insulin and a very quick drop in your blood glucose. And here's another question for Dr. Baxter. Are there any alternative therapies that can be used around the injection site area to help with cooling? Example, essential oils that have that function, realizing that regular oil can interfere with the blood glucose reading.
That's a really interesting question. I think that one of the things that's great about essential oils is that it activates other areas of the brain that also process pain, called the anterior cingulate gyrus. So rather than putting a cooling oil near a site and risking having any kind of a blood glucose change, instead I would focus on having lavender would be good, ginger would be good, some of the same ones that work with nausea. I would focus on having those available to smell deeply at the moment of the injection so that, again, you're using different areas of the brain to process. And there's really no reason not to just use good old cold, a really thin ice pack, not leave it on for very long. But when a very thin, like 20 grams of ice, teeny weeny bit, that goes back to normal body temperature in about 60 seconds. So tiny bit of cold, just I think I would use real cold and not risk those oils, but the oils are a great concept for giving some more distraction and other things to take up bandwidth in the brain.
We're getting a lot of great questions. So here's another one. How important is the expiration date on test strips? Extremely important. If your test strips have expired, that means that the chemical reaction that actually happens when blood goes into that test strip will not be as accurate. And so definitely calling into your provider's office for sample test strips if you need them urgently, or getting a prescription put through, and double checking the expiration date when you pick up your prescription from the pharmacy to make sure that you have, if it's a 3-month supply, those strips will last the full 3 months and you don't have to come back and pay for them again, because it will not give you an accurate blood glucose. And it will, even if the blood glucose is accurate, you will always question the number that you got. Was I truly 90 or was I really supposed to be 190 and it was the test strip that was an error?
And in support of what Dr. Rohr said, we have done that study where we have bought test strips, had a fixed blood glucose, and tested the same blood glucose mixture over a long period of time, in this case 2 years, using the same strips, same meter, and sure enough, with time, the reading of the same blood glucose material changed as the strips became stale.
Yeah, once again, sticking to using those strips before they're expired and exchanging them out when they're not. I've seen so many times where it's affected patients' care and blood glucoses and how they're feeling, most importantly. Another question is there a test to check the level of GLP-1 in an individual? It's not readily available in the clinical setting. So when you go into your primary care doctor or your endocrinologist, we don't check GLP-1 levels. It's pretty much understood that they are going to be decreased in most people with type 2 diabetes. There are studies that look at GLP-1 levels. Those are definitely done in academic centers and require a lot of specific testing as those hormones fluctuate quite a bit. So nothing for regular use in clinic on a daily basis, definitely mainly only for research at this point in time, but that's a great question. And here's another question for Dr. Baxter. How do you help children cope with having to be pricked every day for the rest of their lives?
You know, that's such a huge, overwhelming issue when people first get the diagnosis, but as endocrinologists know, kids do get used to it, and they do get to a place where it isn't a big deal. So what I focus on is the fact that they're going to learn a skill that is going to make them stronger and is going to give them a secret club with everybody else they ever meet who has diabetes for the rest of their lives. And I focus on the fact that we know that they will be able to do this and that we have a lot of secret tricks. But the cool thing is the tricks that they're going to learn to be able to handle this are things that are going to make them stronger in all other areas of their lives. So focusing on our belief in the kid and also the fact that we have to confront our own fears. There was one study that found that 44% of mothers of children diagnosed with diabetes themselves were the ones who were anxious about needles. So we really need to have faith that if we handle it right from the beginning and are confident in the kids, they really do become able to handle their injections. They become able to handle so many more things than they would have been able to when they first started. So step one is truly, as a parent, believe that your child will be able to handle this for the rest of their lives. And while it's not fair, it also gives them a secret kinship with anyone else they ever meet. There's a conference called Friends for Life, and it is kind of a concept that kids with diabetes have so much in common with this growing number of children across the world with diabetes, and they're always going to have that kind of secret club. So focus on power and empowerment, and truly the kids will be able to handle it. They will be able to do it.
And also the Juvenile Diabetes Research Foundation, I believe, has summer camps for children with type 1 diabetes on a yearly basis in most states. So that's something to look into as well, to develop that relationship and that bond with other people with the same diagnosis. And here's our final question. So will any pain relievers like Tylenol help with the pain of injection? So I'll do a quick, I've not noticed any benefit from Tylenol. And if anybody wears a continuous glucose monitor, it will interfere with it reading those subcutaneous glucoses. But Amy, do you have an opinion about this as well?
My knowledge is ibuprofen actually is great with decreasing injection pain if it's given about a half an hour before. But I don't know enough about endocrinology to know if that's contraindicated for diabetes. So Tylenol, not much. Ibuprofen, yes, but can you use it?
Yeah, I mean, and that just opens up a different can of worms. So the Tylenol specifically interferes with a continuous glucose monitor. The ibuprofen, if the patient has issues with their kidneys, chronic use of ibuprofen, especially if they're doing 4 to 6 injections a day, can worsen that kidney
sure.
function.
Sure.
So there's always... go ahead.
Yeah, I would, you know, in the vein of when you start treatment making everything as good as possible, that's where I would say ibuprofen would be something. I wouldn't want to get into using that chronically for life, but when you set up a good environment for the first few weeks, then you're going to have decreased pain and can eventually start getting rid of some of the aspects of the care. So if there's one particular painful place, you know you're going to be putting a pump that always hurts more than 30 minutes before ibuprofen infrequently is what I would recommend.
Perfect. I'd like to thank everybody for listening to us today, and I'd like to especially thank Dr. Baxter and Dr. Jacobs for participating in us having a great conversation. So I'd like to hand it over back to Leah.
Thank you, Dr. Barr, and thank you to our other panelists. We'd like to remind everybody we've got special offers from today's panelists. Buzzy is a breakthrough pain blocker that provides natural pain relief on contact. Visit buzzyhelps.com/diabetes and use promo code AADE1126 to receive 10% off Buzzy Pain Relief products. Genteel makes a painless Lancer. Obtain a $15 discount on your Genteel by going to mygenteel.com and entering dLife15 in the promo box. We also have resources available to anyone that would like to use them. Visit the number one diabetes resource at dLife.com or become a dLife member for free at dLife.com/member. For more information on pain and to purchase Buzzy Pain Relief products, visit www.buzzyhelps.com. For more information to purchase Genteel, the Gentle Lancing Instrument, visit www.mygenteel.com. If you would like free articles on Lancets evaluated and or how palm testing is accurate as fingertips, email Anita at mygenteel.com and simply request the copies. Any questions regarding dLife webinars, please feel free to contact webinar support at dLife.com. Thank you again for joining us, and we hope you have a great day.